Good morning, friends. I am Prabhakar. I am going to explain about the basic informations of electrical engineering. So this will help a lot, this electrical maintenance team, especially operation and maintenance team, those who are working in facility management system, in their day-to-day operations. And it will help them to analyze the problems if they have come across any problems, if they encounter any electrical related problem. Even for higher level also, for example, supervisor, engineers, executives, this will help them to guide their team and brief their team and also convince the customer and client by analyzing the problem and by analyzing root cause analysis. So let us start this. Before starting this electrical basics, I would like to go to the very, very fundamental information about this electrical engineering. As you know that this electrical engineering is originated from the subject of physics. In physics, you know that atomic structure and atomic theory. You see, any material we are going to use in our daily life, each and every material is made out of the smallest particle called as atom. Even in electrical engineering field also, each and every material what we are using in electrical engineering field is made out of the smallest particle called atom. And if you see the atomic structure, it has this nucleus as center, which consists of neutrons and protons. And around this nucleus, you can see so many orbits, also called as paths, in which electrons are moving on their path or orbit. As per the theory, it says these protons are positively charged particles and neutrons are neutral in state and electrons are negatively charged particles. And also it says that same charges repel each other and different charges attract each other. As per this theory, since the protons are positively charged particles and electrons are negatively charged particles, these negatively charged particles, electrons are always getting attracted towards this proton and towards nucleus. So this is the reason they are moving on their path around this nucleus. This attraction force of attraction is inversely proportional to the distance in between nucleus and orbits. As the distance between nucleus and orbit increases, the force of attraction towards the nucleus decreases. Because of this reason, in any atom, the outermost electrons which goes in the outermost orbit are called as a free electrons. Absolutely there is zero force of attraction on them. So these electrons are out of control. So thus are free to move from one atom to another atom. So these are called as a free electrons. And if you take any material, there are this type of millions and trillions of free electrons in that material moving in different directions, in random direction, you can say. When the external force is applied, this external force makes this randomly moving electrons to move in particular one direction. This movement of free electrons in particular one direction is called as current. This is denoted by the letter I. Unit is in amps. And the measuring instrument which is used to measure this quantity is called as ammeter. And the next, the external force which drives this randomly moving electrons to move in particular one direction in a material, that external force is technically called as EMF, that is electromotive force. The meaning of this, the force which moves the electrons in a material. In general, this EMF is also called as voltage. This is measured, this is denoted by the letter V and measured in volts. And the measuring unit which is used to measure this quantity is voltmeter. And the next step, when this external force is applied on a conductor which consists millions and trillions of free electrons moving in random direction, this force makes this randomly moving electrons to move in particular one direction. During this process, when these randomly moving electrons are getting aligned to move in particular one direction, there is a collision, there is a friction among these free electrons before aligning in one direction. This friction, this collision is called as resistance. Because of this friction, the heat is generated. That is the reason normally when a current passes, when current passes through any conductor, the heat is produced in the conductor. So this quantity, this ability, this character is called as a resistance of any conductor. This is also called as opposition. The friction or the opposition offered by this free electrons in any conductor before moving in particular one direction is called resistance. This is denoted by the letter R and is measured in ohms, and ohmmeter is used to measure this quantity. So these are the three fundamental basic terms on which the entire electrical engineering stands on. Again, the relation between these, that is called as Ohm's law. The Ohm's law says the relation between these three quantities. As per the Ohm's law, it says that the current flowing in any conductor is directly proportional to the voltage or the external force which is applied, and inversely proportional to the resistance, that is opposition offered by that. That is what says I is equal to V by R, where I is the amps in current, current in amps, V is the voltage in volts, and R is the resistance in ohms. So as per this relation, you see, current is inversely proportional to the resistance. As the resistance of the conductor increases, the current flow through the conductor decreases. As the resistance of the conductor decreases, the current will increase. In case if the resistance goes zero, then there is no opposition to this, then the flow of electrons will be maximum. That is called as high current. That is also called as dangerous current, heavy current. So this I will explain in later on in the next slides. And the next one, these are the relations and formulas to find out the different quantity. If you know current and voltage and resistance, and even power formulas also be. There's a power and energy, it will be explained in next topic. And but it's a free electrons. Based on the number of free electrons present in any material, depends on this. So these materials are classified into three groups. The first one, conductor, insulator, and semiconductor. Conductor is a material which has maximum number of free electrons, which offers very less resistance to flow of current. In other way, you can say that it is a conductor. It is a material which allows the current to pass through its body. For example, all metals are conductors. Again, the insulator is a material which has very less number of free electrons, which offers more resistance to flow of current. In other way, we can say that it doesn't allow the current to pass through its body. It is an insulator. For example, rubber, paper, cloth, plastic, and so on. And the semiconductor. This is semiconductor is a material which has the both characteristics of conductor and insulator, which lies in between the conductor, neither conductor nor insulator. There are only two semiconductors made available in industry, that is germanium and silicon. Then we shall move to that different type of circuits. What is mean by electric circuits? What it consists, and what are the different type of circuits? Normally we say, if anything happens, that happens in the electrical circuit, then what is the meaning of that circuit? In electrical circuit, you see this, there is a battery. The battery is called as a power sources or voltage source which generates voltage. This is a source, voltage source which generates voltage. Again, there is a lamp which consumes the voltage supplied by and consumes the voltage and also the current supplied by the source. This is called as a load. Source is the device which generates voltage and pass current, and the load is a device which consumes the voltage and current supplied by the source. And there is a switch to control this load, to connect and disconnect load, so that whenever it is required to switch on, you can connect this by operating this. If it is not required, you can disconnect this. This is called a controlling switch. And there are wire pieces or cables which are used to connect these three elements. So the combination of all these three, that is voltage source and the load, controlling switch with the connected wires, this setup is called as electric circuit. Depends on the position of this controlling switch. There are three types of circuits. You see, in this circuit, the controlling switch is opened. In open circuit, see that of course this is generating voltage. We see passing current through this wire till this point. This current will not flow further because this is open. Circuit is interrupted. So it is called as open circuit. In any circuit, the controlling switch is opened. It's called as open circuit. In open circuit, no current flows. And again, in the second circuit, you see, the switch is closed here. So that there is a movement of electrons, the flow of current, which flows through and complete the circuit, passing through this load and goes back to the source. And the current enters from this point, and after passing through the load, it goes back to the source. So this is called as closed circuit. So circuit is closed here. Circuit is completed. And this type of circuit, in this type of circuit, there is a flow of current, flow of free electrons, the flow of current. So you will get the result also. The bulb glows here. So you will get the result in closed circuit. The closed circuit is one in which the controlling circuit is switch is closed. So there is a flow of current in this closed circuit, and you will get the result also. And here you see, from this point, which is connected to this switch, so this is called as a phase, and the current which goes back to the source, this line is called as a neutral. This is also called as return path, which carries current which goes back to the source after completing the circuit. This is called as a neutral. And one more circuit. So there is a direct connection in between this point to this point. Of course, even load is connected on that, switch is also closed. If this line is connected directly to the other end of the source, this is called as a short circuit. I have clearly told about this short circuit in the sense where it offers very, very less resistance. When you connect these two terminals, so the current always takes the shortest route, where the resistance is less. When the circuit is completed without a proper load, without proper resistance, without proper opposition in the circuit, so there will be a high current flows through this because of less resistance. So this is called as a short circuit. In case the resistance is absolutely zero, then it is called as a dead short circuit. The flow in the current in the short circuit is infinity. You cannot count, you cannot calculate, you cannot measure also. It is infinity, countless, which will spoil the entire circuit, including your source and load also. So this is about open circuit, closed circuit, and a short circuit. And next, important measuring instruments and the tools being used and facility management system. There are some set of tools here which is required day-to-day operations. It consists a combination player, screwdriver set, and a cutter, wire stripper, and spanner sets, and etc. Even tester also. And here there is a complete tool kit which has the Allen keys, the spanners, the different sizes of spanners, and the screw spanners, the ring spanners, and all this thing. So these are called as electric tools. For each and every work in electrical engineering field, for each and every work, there is a tool. We have to use that particular tool for that particular work. Use right tool for right work. don't use right tool for wrong work and wrong tool for right work. And then it comes to the measuring instruments. These are entirely different from tools and measuring instruments are entirely different. These measuring instruments are used to measure the quantity, electric quantity, such as current, voltage, resistance, power, energy, like this. As I explained, to measure the current, we are using ammeter. To measure the voltage, we are using voltmeter. To measure the resistance, there is a ohmmeter. And now, all these three instruments are combined in particular one device that is called as a multimeter. You can measure using one instrument, you can measure all these three quantities. And of course, there are some other instruments called as a frequency meter, energy meter, power meter, etc. I will explain about all these measuring instruments like energy meter and a kilowatt hour meter later on in that different topic, another topic. So it is clear that the tools are different and measuring instruments are different. Tools are used to carry out your work, day-to-day operations, and measuring instruments are, these instruments are used to measure on the electrical quantities and other quantities in electrical engineering field. And next, three-phase power generation and transmission and distribution. I explain in brief because this subject takes hours together. In generation itself, it is a very vast subject. You know that the generated voltage in the form of 11 kV and the transmission line, again this line transmits the generated voltage by the generator at generating station to the distant places, and the distribution, that is the other end of this, where it is connected to the customers or users, end users. In between generation point and the distribution point, the generated voltage will be transmitted from distant places by using towers or ports and so many medias. And in between, the generated voltage increased to the very, very high level. I have mentioned here some different ranges of voltage, normally called LT, that is low tension, that is 450 and 230 volts is the consumer end voltage where we are using this, because all our electrical gadgets, electrical equipments, what we are using are designed to operate 415 or 230 volts, not more than that. Again, high tension, if the voltage is 11,000 volt, this is called as high tension or high voltage. And the next range is extra high tension, that is extra high voltage, that is 33 kV, 66 kV, 32 kV and 220 kV. And again, super high tension, super high voltage, this is more than 400 kV. Again, ultra super high tension voltage, that is above 700 kV. These are the different ranges of voltage. Again, the purpose of increasing this voltage to the 700 kV level is to reduce the voltage drop on transmission distribution line. Ultimately, the starting point generated voltage is 11,000, and that ending point, the receive end, the customers or the end users receives low voltage, that is 415 three phase and the single phase 230 volts. And this is on a small, for your understanding purpose. Here it is, if you call this as a generating station, from here generated voltage will be transmitted by increasing the voltage by using the step-up transformers. When it comes to the receiving stations from here, so that transformer, step-down transformers are used to reduce the voltage to that consumer level, that is to three-phase 415 and single-phase 230 volts, so that will be distributed to the consumers, this consumer end. And next, measurement of voltage in three-phase and single-phase. You know that 99.99%, almost 100% of the generated voltage in the form of three-phase only. Normally, three-phase generators are used to produce three-phase voltage because there are so many advantages compared to single-phase and three-phase voltage. If you have three-phase supply, you can reduce, you can tap the single-phase also, two-phase also. And if you generate this voltage in single-phase form, you cannot tap three-phase voltage from there. So there are so many advantages. as far as the submissions are concerned, there is three-phase generation, transmission, distribution, and three-phase missions have so many advantages compared to the single phase. In three-phase, there are four lines. You can see the through four lines at the end secondary side of the transformer. This is line number one, line number two, line number three. That is phase one, phase two, phase three, and this is neutral. In order to identify these three phases easily, different colors of wires and cables are being used. The first phase is identified with the red color. That is R phase. In short, it's called as R phase, or in the sense red. Again, the second phase, this is yellow color wire or yellow color cable. This is called as second phase, that is Y in short. And three phase, that is a blue color. Short form, it is a blue. That is why in three phases are called as R, Y, blue. That is red, yellow, blue. This is the color coding is, it is a standard color code. Even if you interchange these three also, at any cost and under any circumstances, R is always the first phase, red is always the first phase, yellow is always the second phase, and the blue is always the third phase. Again, for neutral, that is a return path which carries the current towards source after completing the circuit. So this neutral is black in color. Normally black wires and black cables are used for neutral. So R, Y, B and black. R is the red first phase, B is the, Y is the second phase, B is the third phase, and neutral is the black is neutral. This is a standard color coding system which is being used and practiced in the transmission and distribution, that is in distribution system. And measurement of voltage. If we measure the voltage between these two phases, or these two phases, or these two phases, I mean, voltage between any two phases among these three, that voltage is called as a line voltage. If you connect voltmeter across any two phases among these three, this is called as line voltage. This is always 415, usually 380 to 440 volts. The standard voltage is maintained at 415. And again, if you measure the voltage between any one phase with respect to this neutral, from this to this, again from this to this, from this neutral to this phase, I mean with respect to neutral to any one phase, this is called a single phase. This usually this voltage is called as a phase voltage. This voltage will be always 230 volts. So it is a clear. The voltage between any two phases among these three, that is a line voltage, it is always 415. And the voltage between any one phase to neutral, this voltage is called as phase voltage, that is 230. That is the reason the single phase voltage what we are using at our houses is always 230. The three phase voltage we are using for three phase machines and all, that is 415 volts. Okay. And one more very, very important information about this. That is a PPE. For each and every electrical equipment and electrical machines, there are so many safety devices to protect the machines and, of course, to protect human being also. Again, as an operator, as a maintenance department, there are technicians, supervisor, engineer, or whoever may be. And these staffs are touching all these equipments and play and also interacting with this three-phase, single-phase voltage every day in each and every shift. And what protective devices they have in case something goes wrong, in case if they come in contact with the live wire. So this is the reason we have to, there are safety devices called PPE, personal protective devices. These are the external devices we are supposed to use, supposed to wear whenever required while working in shifts. These are called as a PPE, personal protective, so that you can protect yourself by wearing this, by using this. For example, see here, to protect your heads, use safety helmet. Protect your eyes, use safety goggles. Protect your lungs, use safety mask. And to protect your ears, use mufflers. And use the safety belts, safety apron, protect your hands and the entire body. Use high insulated rubber gloves. At last, the bottom of that is safety shoes. This is a compulsory. So all these are called externally used protective devices to protect yourself from electricity. It doesn't mean that you have to wear all these PPEs the moment you joined your shift when you are working. This depends on the what type of work you are using. For example, while working at the height, you have to use helmet. While operating the circuit breaker, which is carrying very high current, so you have to use gloves. And working at the height, you have to use safety belt. So, and while taking readings and working with the DGs when they are in running condition in the field, you have to use the mufflers. And while during welding or chipping or doing this any operating electrical circuits, so we have to use to protect your eyes, you have to use goggles. So like this, it depends on the work, what type of work you are going to do. Based on that, which is required for that work, you have to wear. But among these three, one particular safety shoe, it is must the moment you enter inside your workplace. Forget about what type of work you are doing. The moment you enter inside your workplace, you must go wear this safety shoe. This is a compulsory, that is a mandatory. In most of the companies, they never allow any employee, especially operation maintenance team, that is a facility management team, they never allow anybody who goes without wearing shoe. This is compulsory. So this is about personal protective equipment. Please take care. Since you are interacting the high voltage, that is 230 single phase and 415 three phase voltage every day, and most of our staff members, they will be sitting in front of that panel boards which is connected to the high voltage. So please don't neglect. Please wear this PPEs, personal protective equipments, wherever and whenever it is required. So, and the next, at the end of this, there are some problems, the formulas to calculate this power and energy. And I will talk about this power and energy during my next class. These are very, very important. You should know what are the different type of power, electric power we are interacting. So what is the meaning of each and every power, and how to identify this power, and how to measure and how to calculate and how to monitor all these things. So all these things will be explained in brief during my next topic. And there are some questions on this, so that if you have understood all these basic information based topics, so you should be in a position to answer this question. That is, define current, voltage, resistance and instruments used to measure this. And define current insulator, conductor, insulator and semiconductor with examples. And types of electric circuits and important tools and measuring instruments being used. Ranges of voltage transmitted and distributed. And the ranges of voltage, that is LT voltage in three phase and single phase. And what is PPE and requirement of PPE. And thank you very much. Thank you very much.